The Mount Zion Baptist Church is a word-centered ministry designed to evangelize the lost at any cost, equip and empower the people of God, and provide holistic ministry to our community as well as the world. Seeking to minister to the total person, we are a multi-ethnic, multicultural ministry impacting the world in which we live with the uncompromising message of Jesus Christ. Committed to the spirit of excellence, we are striving to become an oasis of hope within the Nashville community by promoting and providing education, awareness, as well as financial independence. We believe that God must be worshiped in spirit and in truth. We embrace freedom in worship because the word says, "Where the spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty." Our foundation is the word of God, and we believe it in its entirety. We believe we can do what it says we can do, be who it says we can be, and have what it says we can have.
Good morning, Mount Zion. Good morning, Mount Zion. I was glad when they said unto me, "Let us go into the house of the Lord." I know that I am not the only one glad, because God have come to set you free today. Is anybody come in the house expecting something from the Lord? Let anybody come here with an expectancy on your mind. Let anybody come here looking for God to do something that you have not been able to do yourself. You've been praying, you've been fasting, you've been crying, but the wait is over. I said the wait is over. You've been waiting patiently on God to do it for you. You know how I know you've been waiting patiently? Because Psalm 46 says, "I waited patiently upon the Lord. He inclined unto me. He heard my cry. He pulled me up out of a horrible pit. He placed my feet on a solid ground. He established my going. He gave me a new song." Some of our song, it should be, "I feel better, so much better, since I laid my burdens down." Come on, somebody magnify the Lord with me. Somebody praise his holy and divine name. Let me say something to you. Your blessing is contingent upon what you speak. Speak what you expect this morning. Come here acting like you want something from God. Come here expecting something from the Lord. Come here looking for that blessing that you've been praying for. Mount Zion, you have been officially called to worship. Let us receive our praise team.
Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Let everything that have breath praise ye the Lord. Lord, we lift your name higher. For your word declares, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. Come on, clap your hands all over the room if you come to lift up the name of Jesus. Everybody just clap, 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 clap. Everybody put your hands together and clap. I will lift up your name.
Higher.
I will lift up your name.
Higher.
Say, right.
You are
wonderful.
Wonderful. I know his name.
Come on. I know his name. I know his name. You say, Jesus over this house. Jesus over our pastor and his family. Jesus over every family in this. those hands as high as you can in the room today. If you really love him, not because someone asked you to, but when you think about his grace, his mercy, his protection, another day that he's blessed all of us to see, to worship him and to do what we're created to do. If you don't do anything else, God, you've done enough. And we love you. Spirit, you're welcome. You're welcome in this place. Fill us, God, with more of you. Fill us with more of your glory, more of your word. We want more. Anybody thirsty for more of him today?
Yeah. his presence. I want to remind you on this morning that we don't have to press into his presence. We don't have to pull his presence. The Father is as close to you as your faith will allow you to believe. So all over the building, if you're expecting anything from God, I dare you just to lift your hands and begin to say something sweet to your Father. He's not far, he's a friend, and he's close. Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus, with hands outstretched, with hearts uplifted, claiming you to be the only true and living God. You are the God who sits high but looks low, who hears every prayer. Father, we thank you for the awareness of your presence on this morning. We're so grateful this morning to know that you said that where two or three are gathered together in your name, that there you would be in the midst. Father, we thank you on this morning that your word declares that if you would be lifted up, that you would draw all men unto you. So, Father, we come with forgiven hearts. We come, God, with clean hands. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that our mercies were brand new on this morning. So there is therefore now no condemnation. We can come to you boldly, declaring and believing that you hear us and that you know us. Father, we thank you that the fervent prayers of the righteous still availeth much. So God, there is nothing too hard for you. God, all over this building, we're believing you for many things. Some need you to show up in their job. Some need you to show up in their home. Some need you to show up in their marriage. Some need you to show up on the college campus, the high school campus, the elementary school campus. God, some need you to show up in their body. And God, you're God enough to do it all. So Father, on this morning, we thank you and we bless you for every magnifying blessing that you're sending, oh God. Father, for every miraculous blessing that you're sending. God, we need something from you on this morning, and we know that you are well able. So God, we put sickness, illness, and disease in your hand. We put anxiety and depression in your hand. We put poverty in your hand, oh God. We put sickness in your hand. Cancer is in your hand. Diabetes is in your hand. God, you are able. We thank you on this morning because we know that you are a well able God. You're a God who hears every cry. And Father, we're asking right now in the name of Jesus that you would just fill us with more of you, Lord God. Father, let no flesh glory in your presence. But God, the men came to honor you. The women came to honor you. College students came to honor you. High school students are here to honor you. Father, we gather for no other reason but to tell you that you are good. We came for no other reason but to magnify your name. So we declare, Jesus, you're the God of all gods. You're the King of all kings. You're the Lord of all lords. There is nothing too hard for you. We thank you for being Jehovah Jireh. We thank you for being Jehovah Shalom. You are Jehovah Nissi. We declare you to be Jehovah Rapha. We call on Jehovah Sikkenu. We need you, Yahweh. And Father, we ask right now that you'll meet every need. Heal every broken heart. Mend every broken heart. Give peace to the mind, Lord God. Father, we call on you right now. And we say, Lord Jesus, send forth a miracle. Send forth a miracle. Send forth a miracle. We don't care what the doctor said. Before there was a diagnosis, there was a healer. Before there was a diagnosis, there was a healer. And God, we call on the miracle worker. We ask for miracle signs and wonders. Miracles. Do anything but fail. And we thank you, Lord Jesus. you're going to do it. And Father, we thank you that he who abides under the shadow of the Almighty shall hide in your presence. So Father, we thank you. He who dwells in a secret place shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. So Father, we thank you that you are our fortress. You are our king. You're hiding us and you're keeping us safe. And Father, we thank you. The wiles of the enemy will not take over. The tricks of the enemy will not win, because we're covered by a sovereign God. And thank you for your sovereignty. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your healing. Father, it's in your name, Jesus, that all over the building, we put our hands together because we believe. We put our hands together because we believe. You are able. You are able. There is nobody like you. We thank you. We praise you. Hallelujah.
You may be seated in the presence of the Lord.
Praise the Lord, Mount Zion. Clap your hands, all ye people, and shout unto God with a voice of triumph. I need one person, two, three, or five people in here who are triumphant in Jesus' name to clap your hands and open your mouth and give God praise. Why? Because he kept us through another week. He kept us through another day. So many people didn't make it, but we're standing here to give God praise. I dare you to clap your hands right there. Hallelujah. We come to offer him praise this morning. Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, Zach, clap your hands right there.
Worthy of the praise. been faithful. We serve a faithful God. We serve a faithful God. You serve a faithful God. Even when you're not faithful, my God is still faithful. My God is still faithful. When I think of what I've done, when I think of where I went, He still has mercy. He still was faithful. Say faithfulness.
Everybody, He is faithful. He's a faithful God. Woo, the presence of the Lord is all in this place today. We thank God for you today, and we welcome you into this place today. We've been rejoicing like this all day long, and of course, we are grateful to God to have you in this house today or watching from wherever you're watching around the world. We thank God for you today. God is truly an amazing God. Can't you feel the power and the presence of God today? Can't you just feel the glory? We're grateful to God. So excited to have you sharing. If you're visiting with us for the first time, we want to welcome you. If you're in the chat, let us know what city you're from, where you are. And of course, if you're in the building, just wave at them. If it's your first time, we want to thank God for all of our first time. Come on, let's thank God for all of our visitors who are sharing. Your family now. Yeah, you and the family, we thank God for you. We don't take it lightly. We're grateful to God for what He's doing. We're so excited about this Bible study. I hope you're being blessed by Soul Care from the salon chair. The women have been laying us out. It's been amazing. A great conversation we had with the married women last week, the single women this week. It's going to be amazing, helping women chart a path. Even through that, it's going to be awesome. We're also incredibly excited about our virtual villagers are back. These are our virtual small groups that we have for men, for women, for couples. It's just exciting. Singles as well. So it's going to be starting back up tomorrow. For more information, click on our website, Virtual Connect tab, for more information. We encourage everybody to be a part of one of these groups. And I'm telling you, it's going to be a game changer for your life. So do that. Of course, our deaf ministry, we thank God for them. They're expanding. And we're looking for those of you who have passion to serve our deaf community. And so if you're interested in doing that, please text ISERVE to 78228. It would mean the world to us to get you involved to help in that area. And of course, we're so excited. You know, we in Mount Zion, we really believe we have the most awesome college ministry on the planet. Anybody can testify to that? We're so excited. And of course, Pastor Christian's doing an incredible job. And of course, we want you to know, look at that. Yes, indeed. Give it up. I know that's right.
We're so excited about that. And of course, our college ministry is going to be hosting a powerful service next Sunday at 7 o'clock p.m. And it's going to be a unique service. I've asked Pastor Christian to host this service, and I've asked him to preach to our college students as we get ready for midterm and to pray over them. And so he's going to be preaching, and we're going to be praying. Our leadership is going to be there. Our church is going to be there to support all of our college students. We support you every week, busing in students, feeding you, and all the things we're doing on every campus. But we want to make sure, amen, that we're doing that. So it's going to happen on Sunday, next Sunday, and it's going to happen at 7 o'clock p.m. We encourage you to be a part. Hope I got that time right. They're moving real quick up there for me. But I do want to make sure that we are definitely at 7 o'clock at the Jefferson Street location. Let's make certain that everybody's there in place. It's going to be awesome next Sunday night. And y'all know y'all need prayer during midterms. Y'all already know I got a witness out there, so I want y'all to be a part of that. And we want to cover you as well. So we thank God for you in advance. Now, we do want you to know September is Sickle Cell Disease Awareness Month, and 1 in 500 African Americans have sickle cell. 1 in 12 have the trait for the disease. And knowledge of personal sickle cell status and community awareness of how sickle cell disease is inherited is vital. And so for more information in this area, visit the Connection Center out in the atrium, out in the foyer for more information. And we encourage you to do just that. Our friend Tasha Cobbs is going to be in town tomorrow. Tasha Cobb Leonard, she's going to be live at the Ryman tomorrow and September 26th. And if you want to save 20% on your ticket with the code Mount Zion, the offer ends tonight 11:59. So if you get a ticket, just make sure you type in Mount Zion. Let them know Mount Zion's in the house tomorrow night at the Ryman. It's going to be a blessing. We thank God today as we getting ready to bless these children today. We're grateful today for the Bliss and Flame Barner, who we're blessing, and Brody Sebastian Daltrow. We thank God for them, Daltrow. Let's thank God for these families as they come. Come on. Right. What a blessing. What a blessing. So, so incredibly excited to be in this moment with you all, to share and to bless your children, and to even know the testimonies behind these children, to know what God is doing. And we are grateful to God here at Mount Zion to cover them. When we do that, we're saying, Lord, put your hand of protection over these children. The destiny that you have over their lives comes to fruition. And we do that, we mean it. And so we're going to pray right now at Mount Zion. Will you just extend your hand in this direction real quick? Amen.
Father, in the name of Jesus, we say thank you. Lord, we give you praise. We give you honor. We give you glory this morning for these gifts that you have given us. Father, we thank you because you have given us these gifts and the very fruit of our wombs. Lord, we know it belongs to you. Father, as they stand before you this morning and we pray over them, we ask your blessings upon them. I pray, God, that you would protect them from the hands of the enemy, protect them from the force of the evil one. May they be blessed. May everyone that surround them be blessed. Father, we honor you. We pray, God, for the parents of these children, Lord, that they would be filled with wisdom, that would be filled with kindness and love, that they would train them up in the fear of the Lord. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. All right. Who we got here?
Brody Sebastian Daltrio.
What's up, Brody? Hey, what's up? All right, there it is. Oh, yeah, you go. Yeah. To see you, man. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. You're in trouble there, buddy. Yes, indeed. What a blessing. Yes, indeed. God is a handsome fella. All right. Woo, who we got here?
Bliss and Flame Barner.
Bliss. Give me the second name.
Flame.
Flame. Yes. Wow. We got twins. Look at there. The testimony blesses me, and how God blessed y'all. Y'all shared that testimony with me. Share a little of it. Share a little of it.
Oh, God. So first off, their names, Bliss and Flame. So we all know the story of the children of Israelites being saved from Egyptian captivity, and God led them with a pillar of fire by night and a pillar of cloud by day. So cloud is bliss, and then the flame is the fire. So it was a difficult pregnancy because identical twins tends to be difficult. So we had some complications, but thank God that they're here.
Praise God. Woo. Amen. Come on, let's thank God for these families today. Thank God. Thank y'all so much. What a blessing. Awesome. 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 I tell you what, it's fertile ministry here, y'all. It's a fertile ministry. Thank God. Amen. Yes, indeed. God has been so good. Has he been good to anybody out there today other than me? Has God been good to you? We're going to prepare our hearts right now to worship God in our giving today because he's been so amazing. And when we give because God's just good like that. And we do it because it's just who we are. We just believe in being generous. And all that God has done in the life of this ministry has been because of generosity of people like you around the world and you in this place today. So let's prepare our hearts and our tithe and our offering. We encourage you to text to give. The information is on the screen right now. But if you desire an envelope, the ushers will come through right now and they will give you one of those and you just drop it off in the drop box outside. We really would appreciate that. But we're so excited about what God's going to do today. Got a word that God's going to release over your life today. It's going to be a game changer, and we truly, truly appreciate that. Pray for our team today. Right after this service, we're jetting out to Atlanta to minister tonight at Changing a Generation for Gospel Baptist Church tonight. And pray for our team as we travel, for Traveling Grace, and also tomorrow night to share with our Atlanta virtual campus, as we'll be sharing in a fellowship with them on Monday night. So we thank God for all of our Atlanta campus who's watching right now in Atlanta. And we thank God. Last week, we were in Huntsville for our Huntsville virtual campus and had a great time. So we thank God as we move around to our virtual campuses, and we're thankful to God. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the privilege we have to give and for the privilege we have to sow into good ground. And we declare, God, blessings over every home, every business. And we thank you that as we remain in covenant with you, you continue to bless the lives of your people now. In Jesus' name, amen.
We've enhanced our text to give option with three simple steps. First, draft a new text message to 267-MTZ-SEED. That's 267-MTZ-SEED. Second, add a giving keyword like tithes, offering, vision, TV partner, or other. And third, provide the amount. For example, to tithe $20, type tithes 20 as the message and press send. Remember to enter only one keyword per text message. You can also give online at mtzionnashville.onlinegiving.org or from the Mount Zion mobile app. Giving at Mount Zion is easier and more manageable.
How are you able to balance work and life? You talk about it being that, like, being there for your children, being, you know, I watch it in real time. I see it. You know, I see, you know, Tuesday night baseball. I see basketball practice. You post this. I see it, right? Rachel, you talk about your kids helping you get ready and do all this, you know, and, you know, Willard being able to have those date nights and how I, as your boss, is like, look, no, you're not doing this. Go with your husband. Like, I'm very sensitive to that, right? Making certain that the blessing of the Lord maketh rich, but it adds no sorrow.
No sorrow. Right. Yeah.
So whatever God gives us is never supposed to cost us our families, our mental health, or anything. How are you guys doing it?
You know, I think, like, being obedient to what God is telling me in my spirit during that time, right? Yeah. And I have to unplug from social sometime because I'm just going to keep it real. Like, Instagram and how you feeling, like, you got to have knees like Megan. You got to make deals like Oprah. You got to cook like Martha. I mean, I'm keeping it real, right?
Yeah,
and you have to do all of that all the time or you're not this whole 2022 woman.
Yeah.
Well, sometimes I'm all of that. Sometimes I'm none of that.
What's up, son? It's good seeing you, man.
Hey.
You doing all right?
Yeah, I'm all right. I'm just a little bit nervous, you know. After Bishop preached Sunday, I just felt something in me respond, and I wound up walking down the aisle and giving my life to Christ.
Yes.
But now, I don't know what to do next. You know, I don't know too much about this Jesus thing. Shoot, I don't even know what to do with this church life, really. I just need some understanding and some clarity.
You don't have to worry, son. Me and your mom, we got you. And guess what? Mount Zion has you. We have the Discipleship Institute going on here. Me and your mom was a part of it, and guess what? You can be a part of that. You grow in your word, you grow by spirit, and we grow in family love. All you have to do is join, and guess what? It's virtual, too.
That's exactly what I need. Where do I start?
Glad you asked. I was just on it. Here you go, right here. So you go here, MountZionNashville.org. You click on Connect, then Tab, and then you got Christian Education right there.
Thanks, Dad.
Hey, we got you.
Hallelujah. Help me thank God for this amazing choir. We thank God for them. Amen. We are ready for the word of the Lord. Amen. One correction on our college service, not next weekend, but the following weekend on the 9th. Please make a note of that, and we look forward to that. Psalm 37. Father, thank you for the word today, and I pray this word will speak to us. Let our faith be strengthened. And God, we give you glory and praise for what you're going to do in this place. Let somebody's soul be saved, and we give you praise in Jesus' name. Somebody say amen. The 37th Psalm, verses 3 through 5, trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and feed on his faithfulness. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. Point to somebody and just say, it's on you. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord today. Every single day you wake up, there are choices, decisions, and consequences. Make no mistake about it. You are presented with choices from a variety of different places and sources, and you don't often control that. But what you do have control over or the decisions you ultimately make. And every decision leads to a particular consequence. God, in his sovereign will, does not insert himself into our decision-making process. He has given us, from the beginning of time, free will. God stands back in hopes that there is enough word, enough morality, values within us that we will choose to make the right decision. When you reflect over your life, as I do often, I am often troubled by some of the decisions that I have made. They cause me to reflect on where I might have been in my life, my relationship with him. What must I have been thinking to make a decision like that? Sometimes you can be sitting next to a decision that you're questioning. You can be working in a decision that you have made. And the reality is that no one is to blame for the consequences other than you, because it's really on you. The cake or the fruit? It's on you. Wait to buy it when I can afford it, or run my credit card balance up trying to impress people who don't even like me? It's on you. Study or party? It's on you. Work out or honey bun? It's on you. Go home or spend the night? It's on you. Now that you're woke, there are many, 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 many choices. But what governs our decision is our relationship with God. Because what you're going to discover today is that your decisions inevitably impact your destiny. How life turns out is the result of the decisions you chose to make. God wants to do so much in your life. He wants to do so much in my life. And it is important to understand human responsibility with that, because we have a role to play in what God does. Us coming alongside God and joining God in this process. And so, if you want your money to get right, it's on you. If you want your marriage to get right, it's on you.
If you want areas in your life to get right, God says, here's what we're going to do. You do all you can do. And when you have exhausted all that you can do, I will then come in and do what you cannot do. But I will not act until you act. And so when David shares this word in the 37th Psalm, it is a word, really, think about it for a moment. It's really a word about focus. How does focus sneak in a text like this? Because what David is really saying is, don't be so consumed with what is happening in the lives of people that you think are blessed, because they have gotten their blessings, quote unquote, through ill gain, through manipulation, that you miss what God has for your life, and therefore you then make poor decisions based on the illusion of their perceived success. So rather than you weep and complain about the inequities that you think you see in the earth, he opens chapter 37 up by declaring, fret not thyself because of evildoers, neither be thou envious of the workers of iniquity, because, see, God deals with that. They shall soon be cut down like grass. Charles Spurgeon says that faith cures fretting. Sight is cross-eyed and views things only as they seem, hence her envy. And faith has clear optics to behold things as they really are, hence her peace. So in the incredible wisdom that this psalm gives to us, we're going to discover some things today, people of God, about the righteous security, because those of us who walk in righteousness have a certain security in God. Actually, David is drawing this from Leviticus 26. He's drawing it from Deuteronomy 27 through chapter 30, that it is the righteousness that God has proven that he would bless those who are righteous and before him. It is the security of the righteous. And so it's important now that when you and I, watch this, walk in righteousness before God, In other words, when you learn to do this, stay in your lane and out of other people's business, and do what God has called you to do and live right before him, all the things that God has promised will come to fruition in your life. I'm going to show you how it happens, because you're going to make the right decisions when confronted with a variety of choices. How do I do that? It starts with character. Your character determines your dependence. Now, the Bible says, trust in the Lord and do good. That is a character statement. What do you mean? Well, character is behavior on display. It's not about what you say. It's about what you do. That's why there was a generation that honored the Lord with their lips, but their hearts were far from him. Because ultimately, God is concerned about what we do more so than what we say. Because, see, in a real sense, how you act is the truest sense of your integrity. So here's the deal. Personality is like perfume. Character is how you really smell. And if you're not careful, the enemy will trick you with personality. They just so nice. They just so fun. Right? But it's personality. But it's not like character. Are you hearing me? Right? So here's the deal. Trust is about dependence. So when I trust is not something that is given lightly as you mature. Now, before you were mature, you handed out trust easily. Like I know I did, you did, all of us trusted people that we wish we had not trusted. We're just so, and sometimes that can be geographical. I mean, let's be honest. Like, you know, I married a woman from L.A. I'm from Louisiana. So that Steph, she grew up in L.A. So, you know, she see the police. She like, speed up and go past the police. They stop somebody. Don't stop. You know, because we in Louisiana, we slow down trying to figure out what's going on. She like, no. We don't rubberneck in Compton. This could be an active thing. Or, you know, my friends who were in school with me on the Northeast, right? They lived in the Northeast, and I'm from Louisiana. You know, they would lock all their doors all the time. I'm from the South. We leave our doors open. Let's run by the house and get some sugar. Because it was geographical. But I think more importantly than geographical, I think it's more so just in terms of our maturation process, how we mature. The more you mature, you begin to realize you can't be as trusting to people as you thought you could. Because when you trust, you're not giving people the privilege of earning it. You got to earn this. See, when you trust, this is important. See, let God be the standard. Because see, now my trust is in him, not in them. See, this is important because the psalmist says, trust in the Lord, trust in the Lord. Now, what does that come from? It means that there are five things I got to remember. The reason I can trust God is, number one, because nothing I go through catches God off guard. I can trust God because I know even though it may surprise me, it didn't surprise God. Even though I may be like, Lord, where'd this come from? He's like, no, I saw that coming because I know your beginning from your end. So this doesn't surprise me. So I can trust God knowing that my life is in good hands because it never catches him off guard. Number two, I can trust God because I know God keeps his word. Unlike a lot of folk who did not keep their word, God keeps his word. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so God said he's going to do it. He's going to do it. I can go to bed on his word. Somebody can be a witness. I can go to bed on what God said. Can you just shout this? I can go to bed on what he said. Number three is that nothing is too hard for him. I can trust God. I'm not going into a situation saying, oh God, what are we going to do? Oh my God, Lord. You know, when I trust God, I don't tell God about my problems. I tell my problems about my God. Number four is that he knows me better than I know myself. There are decisions and things that God did in my life that I was upset at God. But see, God knew me better than I knew myself. And I thought I needed it or wanted it. And God was like, I'm not giving it to you. And then 2 or 3 years later, I'm like, Lord, I just want to thank you for the no's in my life. Because you knew me better than I knew myself. And if you had given me that when I wanted it, my life would have taken a whole different direction. And number five, he's got a reliable record. The fact that God has never failed me yet. I look over my life, man, and God is healed. He's delivered. He's paid ways out of no ways. I mean, anybody here ever check God's record? So I can trust God. Now, here's the deal. When you trust God, what you're saying is, Lord, I trust you enough to release this over into your care, knowing you can do with it better than I can do. Watch this. I trust you to deal with it. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take all my stuff, and I'm gonna say, God, I trust you with it. And while I'm doing that, releasing that to God, I'm also doing good. Here's the hard part. Trusting the Lord and doing good means I gotta keep doing good and let God handle when they do me bad. David says, I want you to know God is fully aware of what happens to the righteous. He knows how the people come at you and how life seems so unfair. He understands how people are manipulative and conniving, how the wicked seemingly prospers, how the wicked abuse the poor, the needy, and they violently oppress the righteous. So God is aware this doesn't get past God, but he says, trust that God's got it. See, stop sitting back telling God, get them, get them, get them. Lord, get them, get them. No, God says, trust me, trust me. I am not somewhere with my head in the sand, unaware of what they've said about you, unaware of what they've done to you. You just keep doing good and let me be God. You keep doing good and let me be God. Stop deputizing yourself to say, Lord, I'm gonna be on the God squad today, and it's my responsibility to help you deal with them. No, God's like, no, you keep doing good. Now, the only way the righteous can keep doing good under those circumstances is that David's arguing here that the word of God has to be in your heart. See, the word of God can be in your head, but not in your heart. And when the word of God is only in your head, then your head, your flesh, would then wrestle and debate with the word of God in those acute moments and stress and crises. Because now your head will start saying, well, you know, God, I just feel like, and I just this and that. But when the word moves from your head and gets in your heart, it then starts governing your morality, your decisions. Because thy word have I hid in my heart that I may not sin against thee. So now, when the word gets in my heart, no matter what comes in my head, the word in my heart always transcends what's in my head, because there is a duality I live with every single day. I'm just going to talk about me. Let's see if I got any witnesses watching around the world or in this place today. The duality that all of us live with is that one side of me is righteous and one side of me is ratchet. It just depends on what day it is.
Some days I feel like being wretched. Some days I feel like being wretched. And whichever way you push me determines sometimes the response you might get. So when I am being pushed into these spaces, right, I have to have something stronger governing my response. So it is the word of God. Hear me well. It is the word of God that's in my heart that allows me, watch this, to love unconditionally and do good. I wrestled with God with this. God, why do I have to love them? God, can I just tell y'all, can I let you kind of eavesdrop on what God and I wrestle with, what I wrestle with God with? It's God, I ain't gonna lie, God, everybody tells me I'm a softy. I keep giving people a chance and they keep hurting me and people telling me I should just be done with that and I should just retaliate. I should do to them what they did to me. And this turn the cheek stuff don't look well on me. Makes me look soft, like I'm not hard. Makes me look like people can just do this to me. And the more I let them do this to me, the more they think they can get away with it. And God, I'm struggling because I ain't gonna lie. You telling me to love people who I helped, who walking around like they got amnesia. I mean, I got the intel. I got the receipts on people and I covered them and they talking about me. And all I gotta do is drop the receipts and their whole life will blow up. And you want me to love them. God, I'm gonna be honest with you. There's some people I hate I got to love. Lord, this is hard. This is wearing me down. God, this is testing me in places I ain't never been tested before because you're telling me that I got to take it, I got to deal with it, and I got to stand back, and I got to keep doing good. I got to show up and dry my eyes and keep on doing good. I got to walk in that place when I know there's no woman there, and I know they've been talking about me because I watched their children. And you want me to keep doing good. And God said to me, son, remember what's in your heart. What was done unto you by the offender cannot become you. Because if they turn you into them, you impede the progress of the blessing I am sending in your life. So what you must understand is that every single thing you have is a result of what's in your heart. Because you are kind, because you are forgiving, because you are loving, that's why I blessed you like I did. And the moment you become like them, you are now going to hold up the blessing and you're going to become one of those fret not thyself. So what I need you to do is I need you, when you start questioning whether or not you should love them in spite of all they've done against you, put yourself in my position and wonder how I love you knowing what I know about you. You made me promises. You didn't show up. You didn't do what you said you were going to do. You were naughty by nature. You did all your dirt, and I still woke you up, still started you on your way, still got you in school, still made a way out of no way. As a matter of fact, I so loved the world that I gave my only son, that whosoever believes upon him should not perish but have everlasting life. Now, what's love got to do with it? So, when they do you wrong, keep doing good. Keep bringing coffee to the office. Keep smiling when you know they don't like you. Don't let it change you. And even if they leave you, don't
give them departure darts. Just let them go and be negative, and you just say, may the Lord watch between us while we are absent from one another, because I'm not going to let you change me, because my blessings are tied to who I am wired to be. Keep doing good. Tell somebody it's on you. Your commitment, your contentment rather, is in him is what is where you dwell. Here it is. He says, now that you got that down, let's dwell in the land and be fed. It's going to be a tough one. Can you dwell in the land and be See, dwelling in the land is about contentment. The Bible says in 1 Timothy 6:6 that godliness with contentment is of great gain. To dwell in the land is to be in the place and the purpose of God, to be where God is. To be where God is. You see, watch this. I have to be where God is. The decisions that I make are always tied to, I want to be where God is moving. I don't want to be nowhere where God is. And the way to affirm whether or not I'm where God is peace. It doesn't mean I won't have chaotic seasons. It just means that I have the peace of God in that place. And see, the more you mature, you begin to realize you have a less tolerance for people and places where God is not. And see, in your spirit starts getting trouble because you start saying, this doesn't feel right anymore. This relationship, this place, this thing. And you're like, what's going on? It's because God ain't there no more. And you start reflecting over your life about what you aided and abetted and accommodated and tolerated that you know God was not in. And so now the shift is happening and you're like, I just want to be where God is dwelling. I want to be where God, I want to be around people who are filled with the Spirit of God. I want to be around positivity. I want to be where God is. And at the end of the day, here's the common denominator. Nothing is worth my peace. I don't care how much you pay me, it's not worth my peace. I don't care how fine you are, it ain't worth my peace. Are you hearing me? I just want to be where God. Some of you in this season, you just made up your mind, if the Lord ain't there, I'm not trying to be there. I want to dwell in this place. As a matter of fact, I'm fed where I'm led. Yeah, see, the places where I am in this season, gotta feed me. I'm done with these unilateral arrangements. Well, I'm just throwing all the pouring out. Ain't nothing coming back. See, no. That's what I dealt with when I just accepted anything. I'm in a place of reciprocity. I'm in a place of this thing's got to be mutually beneficial. So when I'm in a place, it's got to feed me. When I'm in relationships, it's got to feed me. So I ain't got time to be sitting around talking about people and gossiping. That don't feed me. There was a time in my life I sit back and say, what? Say what? But now I'm like, no, what's the idea? What book are you reading? What things are you working on? I need people that are going to feed me. I ain't coming to church just to be all emotional and get caught up and don't get a word from God. I want to be fed. I want my heart to be inspired, my head to be challenged, my spirit to be pushed. I want to be fed. And people don't understand when they don't have the capacity to feed you no more, why you are after more. But see, you cannot apologize, nor should you lower your standard. You got to declare, iron sharpens iron, and I want to be where I am fed. And in this season, the Spirit of the Lord is going to lead you into places where you will be content dwelling where you are fed in the land. Here's the deal. When you are spirit-led plus spirit-fed, it equals a sinful life dead. Your convictions can determine God-given your heart's desire. Your level of conviction is tied to your level of commitment. Conviction, strong belief. I'm committed to what I believe. The Bible says God will give you your heart's desire. Boy, this is one of the most misunderstood and misapplied scriptures in the whole Bible. God said he was going to give me the desires of my heart. Did you read what was before that? See, your desires, watch this,
have to line up with his will, which is his word. And the way this begins is that I must delight in him. I must find pleasure in my relationship with God, that this thing becomes organic. It becomes natural. You see, there was that moment of maturation all of us go through. I grew up, my brother and I, we grew up, my sisters who are watching, we grew up, my dad was a superintendent of Sunday school, so we used to go to church. Sunday school started at 9:30. We had to get there like 7 in the morning to light the heater. We hated it. We'd be like, I don't want to go. But we went, and then one day we started enjoying church, and then it just happened organically. But my dad had enough sense to put us in the right environment. He never forced us. My mother never forced it on us, but they put us in the right environment to where we came to experience Christ for ourselves, to the point that then we started getting up saying, is it time to go? Because it became organic for us. That's why I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Put your family in an environment that it can then grow on them. You put them in other environments, and that's why the other stuff grow on them. But when this thing becomes organic, now nobody has to tell me to raise my hand. Nobody has to tell me to open up my mouth, because I want to do it. It's the relationship. So there is a distinguishing difference. Watch this. Between in a relationship, you're doing something because you know you should, and you're doing something because you want to do it. One is based on rules. The other is based on relationship. I'm only doing this because I want to do it, because I know I need to do it. It's like a person says, you know, I'm opening the door for you, baby, because I'm supposed to do it. I'm cooking because I'm supposed to do it. It doesn't mean you want to do it. That's why when you're cooking, angry. I'm sick of this. Y'all come in here and sit down. This place times. Worked all day. I'm sick of this. See, because you're doing it. You are doing it, but you don't want to do it. But when you do it out of relationship, that's why the Bible says, serve the Lord with, because you absolutely want to do it. So when you see people serving in ministry and they complaining, I'm so tired, I'm so sick, they always ask, you don't really want to do it. But there are some folk up here today, you really want to be here. You really want to give God glory. You really want to serve God. So when you love God like that, you delight in the Lord. I don't need nobody to push Jesus on me. I love him by myself. Whether or not there's a drum beat, a praise leader, whether or not somebody tells me to lift my hand, I just want to give him glory because he woke me up. He started me on my way. I'm giving him glory because I want to do this. Now, he knows my heart. He knows what's in my heart. Statement we use all the time. The Lord knows my heart. But remember, I told you, the word is what's in your heart. So if the word is in your heart, the desire doesn't come from your head. It comes from your heart. See, because your head will get you in trouble. Let me break this down. You gotta get this. If God will give me the desires of my heart, then that means my heart is the word of God, which is the will of God. So let's see how this works. So Dr. Steph and I, as our custom every Saturday, we take the kids after the activities, after we get through running all these places like most parents do on Saturday, it's time to go lunch. So we go, Chick-fil-A sometime, we go various places. So wherever we go, Joseph wants the same thing no matter what he orders. I want this, that, and French fries. What you want, Joseph? Da-da-da, and French fries. So yesterday, we went to Whole Foods, True Foods. And we went to True Food, and True Food Kitchen, we like to go there. And it's more healthy options, and we're going there. And I've got to prep him on the way. We're walking into the restaurant, and I'm getting them ready. Joseph, let me just explain.
they don't have French fries. He already getting upset. I want French fries. Bruh, listen, man. Settle yourself. They don't have French fries. We get in the restaurant. God's my witness. We get in the restaurant. I'm trying to coach him through this. We sit down. I want French fries. He's starting to get emotional. I want French fries. Now, Dr. Steph and I, we, you know, we getting ready to get the orders down. Here I am, foolish, showing him the menu like he can read at 4 years old. Look, there are no French fries on the menu. Well, he takes the menu and grabs it and points like he can read right here, trying to turn some into French fries. French fries right here, Daddy, pointing to something else. I'm going somewhere. He pointing to the menu, can't read it, but trying to convince himself that that says French fries. Oh, I'm going somewhere. As the elder in the room, I know, Dr. Steph knows, we're going to order this boy pizza. Because we got sense enough to know, even though he crying and pouting and got them the tears over there, want French fries. We know that when that pizza show up, his hunger is going to override his desire for French fries. And he going to take what was on the menu. God's word is his menu. And you out here talking about French fries, French fries, French fries. And we telling you that ain't on the menu. She ain't on the menu. He ain't on your menu. It ain't on your menu. But I want it. I want it. I want it. It ain't on the menu. And God has to sit back and watch you pout, watch you cry. But God knows when he finally delivers what his will is for your life, your hunger for it is going to make you forget you asked for that foolishness in the first place. Do I have a witness up in here today? And you're going to be just like Joseph. This good. Oh, come taste that. See that the... Yeah. Got it? Listen. That's how God gives you the desires of your heart. Let me close. Your commitment determines when he will deliver. Now, the Bible says, it's confirmation, that God will bring it to pass. Here it is. I'm getting ready to wrap this up. There are people who have yet to realize that God is going to do what he said he's going to do. It may take a while, I know. And some of you are saying, well, God, what's taking so long? What you doing? But it's going to come. Listen carefully. When you commit your way to the Lord, God moves. But it's really on you. It's your level of commitment. What do you mean? You have to be mature enough to handle the blessing. This is the point where God will never release blessings into the hands of uncommitted people. When you are uncommitted, you will act committed to get it. And as soon as you get it, you bounce. Praying for the relationship. Jesus, move now. Do it. And the moment you get it, too busy for God. Praying for the job. Do it, Jesus. Move now. And the moment you get the job, God don't see you no more. Praying for the financial blessing. And then God blows your mind. And then God doesn't see a dime of it. Praying for tuition to be paid. Do it, God. Don't let him purge me. Then God does it. And then God don't see you again until next semester when tuition is due all over again. Commitment is about consistency. When a thing is committed, it becomes consistent. That is the mark of maturity. And can God count on you when God blesses you?
Here's the real question. How high can God take you without losing you? Can God take you to places and you still give him glory and say, God, I want to thank you. I want the world to know I didn't get here by myself. It was nobody else but God. It wasn't my money, my degree, my family. It was nobody else but you. Can God bless you and you still take God to the places where he blesses you? Listen, I want to speak this prophetically. I do. I want to speak it. I want to release a word over your life prophetically. I don't know who it's for, but I'll know in just a moment. But you've been praying and believing God for something in your life, and you heard this word, and here is the summation of the matter. It's on the way. I said it's on the way. What you've been praying over, what you've been fasting over, what you've been on your face over, God said it is en route to your house. And you must understand that you just keep doing good, you keep on trusting God, you don't let these people get on your last nerve, don't let them change your character, you keep on giving God glory, putting your trust in God, don't be retaliatory, vindictive, don't walk around with pride and say, God, it's all in your hands, I'm doing my part, it's on me. God says, I will bring this thing to pass. And so here it is. I said to God, well then God, help me help the people understand, what should we do while it's on the way? And boy, God spoke to me. Dr. Steph and I were in Atlanta Thursday night, and God spoke to me, and I said, I got to release what that word was over this house. God said, son, teach the people to give me glory while it's en route. He says, now, but what I want you to show them is how, once they give me glory, before they ask for the thing, to put their name on it. I said, what? He says, put their name on it. And then I got it. Go to Chick-fil-A, and I am the one that's always in a hurry, always pull up in the Chick-fil-A, say, I'll have it. They're like, sir, what's the name for the order? Because they are not going to start processing the order until they have a name. And God said to me, that when you release your name, he takes your name and ferries your name into rooms, drops your name into people's spirits, and he uses those people to turn around and say, I don't know why I'm blessing you, but your name came up in my spirit. So when you give God glory, just go on and release your family name. Go on and release the name over here and say, God, bless the Walker family. Lord, bless the Thompson family. Whatever it is, I declare as you give him glory, say your name. And when you say your name, God is carrying your name in the rooms. I'm going to give you 60 seconds to fill this house with glory, to open up your mouth and give God glory, because what you're waiting on is in route. Somebody didn't tell you, right? Somebody clearly didn't remind you, a closed mouth don't get fed. Open up your mouth and give God glory. Somebody watching right now around the world. Somebody watching in California. Somebody watching in New York. Somebody watching in Georgia. Somebody watching in Alabama. Somebody watching in DMV. Open up your mouth. Somebody on that balcony, open up your mouth. Somebody on this floor, open up your mouth like you lost your mind and give God glory. I declare and decree, it's on the way, exceedingly, abundantly, above all God could ask or all you could ask or think. It's on the way. It's on the way. It's on the way. Lift your hands all over this place. Real quick, wherever you're watching around the world, lift your hands. Lift your hands.
God is doing it now. Keep walking in righteousness, trusting God. Don't let these folk change you. Keep doing good.
Sooner or later,
God's gonna give you the desires of your heart.
It'll turn in my favor.
You know what? He's what?
Turn it around.
For you. For you. For you. It's what? It's turning.
It's turning around.
One big choir.
It won't always
be. Encourage yourself. Come on. Encourage yourself. Why? Because the Lord will do what? He'll perfect. That which concerns. So today, here's my word. It's gonna turn. Woo!
It's turning around.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord, it's turning. Listen right now, all over this place and all around the world, there is nothing more profound, nothing more important than being in the will of God to say, Lord, I trust you. What you've heard today warrants a response from you. It's on you. You want your family to get right. You want the blessing of the Lord to come upon your life. It's on you. And whether you're in that balcony on this floor, I'm going to give you these opportunities. Number one, I need a relationship with Jesus Christ. Number two, come on, I need to get my life right with him. Number three, I need a church home. Number four, I'm here relocating to Nashville. I need a covering. I want you to get to this altar as quickly as you can. And as you come, somebody's going to stand with you. Right now, I want you to move. Right now, it's on you. It's on you. It's on you. You can pray all day long, but you got to understand that faith without works is dead. Come on, that's it. And as you come, somebody's going to stand with you. Come on, church. I want you to give God glory as they make this walk today. Come on, come on. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, come on, church. Come on, church. Come on, come on, come on. That's it. That's it. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Come on. He's turning around. Come on, come on. Declare it. Come on.
It won't always be like.
Come on. God has great plans for you. Come on, church. Give God glory. Would you give God glory for all of these lives making that decision today? Come on. Yes, 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 yes. Come on. Come on, come on. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. It's turning around. Come on, come on. Watching me all around the world, on the screen right now is the word salvation, and there is a number I want you to text. If you're watching me around the world, we can connect with you that way. Salvation at 78228. But I just want you to hear this as I get ready to close this out today. But I just believe, listen, the worst thing you could ever do is get a word like this and then say, God, next time. Man, let me tell you something. The Bible said that the very day you hear his voice, harden not your heart. There are choices, but you make the decision, and the decision will impact your destiny. This next 30 seconds, you're on the clock. You don't know what will happen when you leave out of here. What will happen this week? But the safest place is in the will of God. I believe I got a witness out there now. And if you had 30 seconds to forget about other people's opinion, to forget about peer pressure, and to say, I just want to be where God is and where he wants me to be, God will, he will honor you. He will bless you. And today, these next 30 seconds, they start right now.
now. Church, are you praying? Because I believe if you pray, they're going to come. I believe if you pray, they're going to make that walk today. Come on, that's it. That's it. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, this is a destiny move. This is a destiny move. That's what this is. This is a destiny move. Come on, come on, come on. This is a destiny move. That's right, that's right. That's right. Sooner or later. Come on, come on.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what this is. Yeah, yeah.
Sooner or later.
Sooner or later. Come on, put your hands together. Come on, put your hands together and help me thank God for every one of these decisions today as we celebrate what God is doing in your life. And Father, I thank you for every life, every decision today, those around the world, those at this altar today. And let today begin the best days of the rest of their lives. Let this not be a moment, but be momentum. Let this be a commitment of consistency. So we thank you in the name of Jesus, and we give you glory that the best is yet to come. In Jesus' name, amen. Each one of you on that screen right now, I want you to take your phone. It's going to be the best text you ever send. I want you to text the word salvation. The people that are around you, they're going to make sure before you leave here today that you do it. I want everybody to make sure and let nobody get out without texting that word salvation to 78228. That's how we're going to follow up with you. So we thank God your friends brought you down. Make sure you don't leave here without that number, salvation, to 78228. We thank God today. Has God been good to you today? Come on, has he been good to you? Did you receive that word today? Thank God for it. I thank God today. And so we pray God's blessings over you and your family. We pray increase come upon you. We pray that God will continue to make his favor shine upon your life, that you leave here going in the will of God and in peace. We thank you, God, for all that he's going to do in and through you and your family. And we pray continued blessings upon you as you leave this place and never God's presence. In Jesus' name, amen. Be blessed. God bless you. Thank you so much. Thank all of you. Come on, let's thank God. Amen. God's amazing.
Sing it choir, it's turning around.
It's turning around.